Good afternoon, everyone. And our president is also available here. So first of all, I request our president to kindly address the meeting. Dr. Ashok, sir.
Thank you, Govind. Good afternoon, friends. I'm happy to greet everyone over here on the behalf of the Jharkhand Orthopedic Association, JOA. I, President Jharkhand Orthopedic Association, welcome everybody in this webinar today. We will focus on basic course of total hip replacement today. I heartily welcome our guest speaker, stalwart Dr. Indrajit Sardar, sir. He is a distinguished consultant in orthopedics in Kolkata. He is a very academic person with numerous papers in August gathering. To add, he has been president of Indian Society of Hip and Knee Surgery and also president of West Bengal Orthopedic Association. My regards, Dr. Indrajit, sir.
Thank you.
I welcome Dr. Nishikant Kumar, another faculty speaker today. He is HOD Department of Orthopedics in Medi-Varsal Hospital, Patna. He has special interest in trauma and joint replacement surgery. The way he treats his patients is out of the world. Each and every point he discussed thoroughly with the patient. Welcome, Dr. Nishikant. I appreciate Dr. Rajiv Raman, our coordinator over here. He's a good composer and a good friend of mine. My special thanks goes to him. I welcome our speakers and panelists from Jharkhand. Dr. Rohit Lal, our dynamic joint secretary, Dr. Nirmal Kumar, Dr. Rakesh Agarwal, Dr. Subhendu, and Dr. Unmesh for joining us today. I acknowledge Dr. Samtul Hoda and his team, Ortho TV and IOA TV, for their technical support. Finally, I welcome and thank my audience who have spared their time for being with us. I conclude by inviting my Honorable Secretary, Jharkhand Orthopedic Association, Dr. Govind Gupta, who is also moderator of this webinar today. Thanks, everyone. Dr. Govind, please.
Thank you very much, sir. First of all, on behalf of Jharkhand Orthopedic Association, I welcome our guest speaker, Dr. Indrajit Sardar, sir, and Dr. Nishikant, sir. So, to start the proceeding, may I request Dr. Indrajit Sardar, sir?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the very kind introduction. One little correction is that I was not the president of the ISH thing, but I was president of the Indian Arthroplasty Association for 1 year. So now, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Then I can start. It's nice to be with the Jharkhand Orthopedic Association, Dr. Ashok, Dr. Govind, and I have very old and dear friends there, and it's a place I love visiting. And only this stupid pandemic has put a break on all those visiting things. But total hip replacement is now everywhere. It's all over the country, in all states, all tier one, tier two, tier three cities, and many persons are doing the total hip replacement. But the key note to this is placing the acetabular component right. So that's really is the key to the whole thing. The rest of it falls into place. The femoral thing is much easier to do, but this is the whole thing. The initial thing is templating. And for the templating, the one thing that would help you a lot is that you have a horizontal view box on a table, because then you can use all these templates on it and trace easily. If it's up there on a wall, it's very difficult putting them on and tracing them all over the place. So this helps you. It's not a very difficult thing to do, but it helps you really a lot if you are going into total hip replacement. So the templating part of it gives you a lot of good things. and is an essential part of doing a total hip replacement. It gives you the size of the femur, the acetabulum that you're going to use. It gives you the leg length discrepancy. It gives you the area where you're going to cut. It gives you the offset. You're calculating all this, and also the angle into which you're going to put the whole thing. You can identify the center of rotation of the hip, and you can see that they both come to the same level. There are many other things also, but templating is an essential part of the entire thing. So proper cup orientation plays a very important role in PH elongation, and that is the key. This range of motion is dependent on it, and is the rate of dislocation. So there are three things really important in this cup placement: depth, height, and angular placement. And we'll take up each one of them. The depth is the optimum cup position. If you have a good acetabulum like this, then all you have to do is an anatomical placement. And that anatomical placement depends on the bony landmarks, as you can see, and the other things which we'll come to. But basically, you do an acetabular reaming 4 millimeter more than the femoral head size. Once you have done that, then you orient your placing by the transverse acetabular ligament and the labrum. And this, if the native acetabulum is good without any deformity, this is the way to go. And it's a much simpler and easier thing to do. The problem starts when you have a shallow acetabulum. The question comes, do you medialize? And if you do medialize, by how much? Charnley used to medialize all his hips because of better biomechanics. But one thing you have to realize, that if you medialize too much, you must make sure that you have a good variety of stem offsets, which is not always present most of the time. So depending on what stem offsets you have, that's an area where you have to think of the depth of the medialization that you do. The reamer, basically, if you target height, should be cradled by the transverse acetabular ligament and the labrum. And then the other thing, important thing, is the teardrop. In the correct inclination, the inferior extent of the cup should not be above this teardrop, should be at that level. And next is the relationship between the superolateral most point of the bony acetabulum and the lateral extent of the templated acetabular cup. I'll just describe this a little bit more later. And what we do, you can, for measurement of the leg length during this procedure, if you have done a clinical examination and you know that you have to improve the leg length by this much, sometimes you can't really correct everything, but you can have a fair idea of how much to correct. So you take this from the superior acetabulum, and this is the greater trochanter, and you make a point, you make a knot there, and that's a thing that you try and increase it once you've finished your implantation in reference to this. So then you know that your leg length has also been corrected to a great extent. And now this target angular position that I was talking about. So if you template, and that's one of the great advantages of templating, if you template like this, then this is the lateralmost portion of the acetabulum. And this is where your cup is going to go. And that you find that there's a distinct difference between the two over here, say 3.3 millimeter. Then when you're operating and you're put in the trial, and you again check that if it is 3.3 millimeter, then you'll have a very good idea that you are in the correct inclination, and that will help you a lot in positioning the cup. You have to understand that a 12.7 degree variation between the implanted inclination angle and the final position on radiographs happen. And this is due to the movement of the pelvis. Whichever position you are in, if you're going by the lateral decubitus, or you're going by the supine decubitus or posterior, you've got to fix the pelvis properly. But even then, the pelvis tends to go into adduction and inclination in different positions. So this method is one of the simpler ways of knowing that you're implanting your acetabulum right. The other thing is, of course, is the use of the tal to guide antiversion. You have to be parallel to the tal and just inside. And you can also go by the psoas groove, which happens in the anterior part. This is the anterior border. So stay just within the anterior border. And the other thing, how much have you reamed? There's this interesting sign called the three blush sign. So this is one, this is two, and this is three. If that is there, then you know that you've done a very adequate job and your cemented and your uncemented cup is going to go in very well into this. So the changing directions and changing positions I've talked about, and we're all aware of that, supine, posterior, whatever way you go, your inclination is going to change. And the other important thing to look for is the spino-pelvic alignment. The lateral views of the lumbosacral spine in sitting and standing position. And that's important because in people with normal spine pelvis mobility, there is a posterior tilt of 20 to 35 degrees when you move from standing to sitting. And especially in ankylosing spondylitis, this is 4 degrees less. And in ankylosing spondylitis, if the lumbar spine is flexed, there is more antiversion of the hip and the acetabular reaming should do that. So that's another area which you have to look at and then base your acetabular positioning. The final acetabular positioning must be placed parallel and superior to the transverse ligament, just superior, inside the anterior wall notch of the true acetabulum. So that's why it's so important to expose the acetabulum very well. And then you adjust for the femoral version and pelvic tilt and obliquity. And a weight-bearing radiograph is great if you can have that. If you do have it, try and get it. After you have done your cup antiversion, there are many ways of post-op x-rays to detect. There is Fabex method, there's Pradhan's method. Pradhan was from Mumbai. His method is very good also, Widmer's method. They have this huge templates in which you line up. Then the Leo's trigonometric method, all this, a little bit of complex calculations. And then there are these softwares, etc. And of course, a CT scan. So these are the ellipses which occur during the positioning. And you get this one, this big ellipse. And over here, you get this longitudinal axis. And then this distance over here is important. And from this, you can also calculate your angle as to where you're going it. So all this helps a lot in positioning your acetabulum. So what is the right position? There is a lot of variety, and if you look at all the literature around, there is 40 degrees abduction plus minus 10 degrees. So basically 30 to 50, that's a good range. But we generally tend to go at 45. A 10 degree antiversion is ideal, but plus minus 15 degrees. So there are authors who want a 5 degree, and there are authors who want a 25 degree. That's a huge variation. But the 10 degree antiversion is okay for most people. You must have a uniform cement mantle of about 3 millimeter. And in the uncemented cups, you can get 80% coverage to 100% coverage. In the sort of the Duraloc cup, you get 100% coverage. It's, everything is covered by bone. But in the Pinnacle, you have to uncover a little bit of the top because of the hemispherical nature of the Pinnacle and screws of proper length. So eccentric cement mantle led to earlier cement fractures and loosening. And there are a lot of papers on it, which you can read as you go along. And if you look at this, you can see the cement mantle on top and the cement mantle here. And if there's a 2 millimeter difference in this, there's a lack of concentricity, and that probably leads to a higher incidence of cement fractures and then subsequent loosening. The Luenik did the safe zone, which I'll come to soon. The outside safe zone dislocation rates are 6.1%. Inside the safe zone, dislocation rates are 1.6%, even 1%. So this is an area which you should look at. The Luenik zone, as I said, 45 degree, you should aim at 10 degrees antiversion, give or take 5-10 degrees this side. So how to achieve this? You look at the x-ray, but you expose the acetabulum, especially the margin. And that is the entire key to the procedure. And then you look at the acetabular reference points. 40 degrees or 45 degrees is safe. Don't compromise on that. And then there are the pelvis reference points. So if you look at a normal x-ray, and if this is overshadowed by the femoral head, so it's difficult to see, you need a high quality x-ray on that. And this you can see over here, and this is the anterior and the posterior, and there's a gap between them. But if you look here, the gaps are practically diminished, reduced in certain acetabulum. This is perfect. This is a good acetabulum, but the gaps are reduced. And if you look closer to that, in the increased acetabular version, the anterior and the posterior borders are far apart. The posterior border is here, the anterior border is here, and you're sure that there is some sort of antiversion over there. But if it is retroverted acetabulum, then this posterior border goes medial to the anterior border. And that is an idea which you can have on the X-ray, good quality digital X-ray, to know what acetabulum you're really dealing with. So expose the acetabulum. This is the sort of acetabulum you have to see. Everything, all borders exposed, all borders gone, very easily done. This is, I think this was a supine position, but also in the lateral position or posterior position, whatever you can also get. You have to expose the entire acetabulum, and that is the entire key. And this is another one. This, I think, is the lateral decubitus. So whatever position you are in, you have to expose the acetabulum. And once you have exposed the acetabulum, once you are reaming, you have to place, go get the reamer inside the anterior border and over here on the, this over here that is going in, on the almost a rim fit, a little bit of uncoverage over there in the uncemented hips. And once you are putting in your cup, again, a little bit of uncoverage on this side is okay, you're allowed that. Inside is this, and below this is the tal, and you have to be just inside and parallel to the tal. Once you have done that, and once you have achieved that consistently, you will get an excellent acetabular position in most of your cases. If you translate that into anatomical things, this is the acetabulum, and this is the bony thing over there. Over here is the pubic bone. So this point is this point, which you can feel. The superior point is this point, which you can feel and see. And over here is the one which the ischial portion, the ischial pubic ramus. And having identified these three things, you are in a great position to get a very good idea of where to place the acetabulum. If you look at the tal thing, and you have to be, and this is for the pinnacle cup, you see, if you place the rim fit with a pinnacle cup, you are not getting inside the tal. There's a huge difference there. Once you do that, you put it there, you'll see this area of uncoverage. 20% or so of the acetabular cup is left uncovered. If you go over the tal alignment in the pinnacle cup, in the dural lock, everything is inside. So whatever cup you're going to put in, whatever company, you try it first and see what are the areas and how much area we have to left uncovered. And that's where templating comes in, so important. Therefore, when you template, all you have to do is to place your template in such a position that this templating portion and over there is uncovered in the pinnacle cup. And once that is uncovered, you get that idea that this is where you're going to place it, and that is the amount of the overhang that you can accept. This is a cemented hip, and you can see over here the cement portion of it is more or less uniform. But over here, there is more thickness here, less there. But as the difference is 2 millimeters, this is a 12-year case, which is now absolutely with no problems. So even though the cement mantle is important, the difference between the thickest and the thinnest part would be less than 2 millimeters. When you are in the supine position and doing the anterolateral approach, you place a rod on both anterior superior X1s, and you go 45 degrees to that. Now, most of these cases in the supine position, you put a sandbag underneath the near hip such that that anterior superior X spine is elevated. And how much elevated is, that is the thing which you look from the, by joining that long rod of the both things and how much it's elevated from the horizontal. So that is your antiversion of the acetabulum. So lift your hand holding the acetabulum that much. If you look at this, this is a raw figure. I'm not a great one for diagrams, but this is the anterior superior iliac spines, and this is the horizontal, and you correct this, and this is the way it is up. It's up by this much. And over here, when you're doing the 45 degree to this line, which is a straight line, then you lift your hand up by that amount over here, and that will give you, correct that extra antiversion that you've given to the hip by elevating it for a better exposure. In the lateral position, of course, is the same thing, but in the lateral position, you have to fix it very well. That is the whole key. And here the surgeon, assistant, everyone must get in, see that the patient is stabilized in that position. Because if it moves, your guideline is this shoulder over here. And you aim for the shoulder over there, and you go for that. And together with that, once you're in that line, You just rotate this thing this way to get the antiversion right. So which is better, supine lateral or lateral lateral? In this randomized controlled trial, higher accuracy of acetabular cup inclination was provided by the supine position than by lateral position on TH. There's no difference in the antiversion. And this is a 2019 paper. So the whole thing is that in the supine, and that's the one I trained with, and that's the one I really use most of the time. But there are problems in the supine position in the obese patients. And in the obese patients, if you took the lateral decubitus and the supine, then you'd find that the worse outcomes was with the lateral, the supine position than the lateral decubitus group. So obese patients, we go for lateral, and in the supine position for the average thin patients. This side is a supine position, and you can see a fairly good uncemented cup placement. There is a little bit of overhang here, as we've discussed before, and over here, it's the teardrop, it's inside. But if you look at this in the lateral position, everything was done well, but you see this has gone inside more, as a result of which should have been this way, has gone a little bit horizontal or closed, and this portion is uncovered. This doesn't usually lead to much problems. It leads to a slightly worrying extent, but all of this is a very stable thing, because in this case, the surgeon could give a 36 millimeter head, which is very stable in most cases. If you want a uniform cement mantle, this is the way I do it, is you put a little more cement at the bottom, and then you pressurize the cement with the gauze-filled gloves like this. I'm sure all of you have used this. And once that thing is pressurized, then you put the cup in with a pusher. But remembering, when you put the cup in with a pusher, you push the rims of the cup with your two fingers from both sides, over here and over here, and then push with the pusher. After some time, when the whole thing is getting sticky, you remove your two fingers and assess the cup whether you want to change it or not. You still can change 5 degrees, but try not to. And then after you are satisfied with the position of the cup, you re-push with the pusher and hold it till the cement is strong. So is templating essential? I think templating is extremely essential, mainly for those who do low volume centers, less than 100, which is the situation in most cases. In 71% of cases, the implant inserted was within one implant size of the templated acetabular cup, and that's great. And the most important thing is the surgeons can focus more attention on the hip biomechanics, they can anticipate the correct implant sizing, and they can identify the potential difficulties prior to surgery. So this was templated, this was not. And you can see how vertical this cup has happened, which is another worrying thing. So basically then, after all this information, how are we doing? Acetabular cement mantles and the component position, are we achieving ideal results? 2006 Journal of Arthroplasty, radiographs of 100 primary cemented total hip arthroplasty. 78% of the components were eccentrically placed with increasing cement mantle thickness from zone 1 to zone 3. Even though the average opening angle for all 100 components was 46, which was perfect, but again, the cement mantle part was not that great in 78%. And if you look at the uncemented arthroplasties, so the component version in total hip, so this got the, it was October 2000 Australian Association. So they did 111 primary total hip arthroplasties. They were evaluated intraoperatively by the surgeon, and then they were compared with the postoperative CT scan. So the surgeon said that the acetabular and femoral components were all within 10 to 30 degrees version, with a mean of 16 degrees and 16.4 degrees. So that's a great thing that they did and felt very pleased with themselves. Once the CT scan was done, that ranged from 12 degrees retroversion to 52 degrees antiversion. And similarly, the femoral component version ranged from minus 15 retroversion to 45 degrees antiversion. So again, that's so important to do your templating, look at all the available bony points that you have, and then take great care in implanting it in that exact position that you want to. A new fellowship-trained arthroplasty surgeon must perform 50 consecutive THs to achieve a satisfactory level of competency in the acetabular position. And even for the experienced surgeon, between 39 and 50% of acetabular cup placement fall outside the Luenik and abduction antiversion safe zones. And this came out in 2015 in the Journal of Arthroplasty. So you have to be careful all the time, even if you are experienced, because you can make the same mistakes which a new person is doing. According to the CT calculation, only 71% of femoral, and remember, as we are talking about acetabular, 45% of acetabular components were within the expected clinical version range. So the intraoperative estimation of acetabulum and femoral version in total hip arthroplasty is of limited accuracy, but that's the only thing we have when we are doing it. So is the Luenic safe zone sacrosanct? Another paper in 2016 said that the cup placement was within the Luenic abduction safe zone in 92% of patients who dislocated after undergoing a posterior THA, and 65% of patients who dislocated after an anterolateral THA had their cup placements within the Luenic safe zone. So the title was, what safe zone? The vast majority of dislocated THAs are within the Luenic safe zone for acetabular component position, for 2016. So basically, again, the question arises that the dislocation part is not only dependent on the Luenic safe zone, but dependent on many other factors, especially the postoperative ones, and the head size, the offset, and others, not only the acetabular version. So that's a very important part. This is a busy slide, but this is all summarizing what I've said before: depth, height, anti-angular placements, and the ways that is being done. It's too busy to really worry on a Sunday afternoon, but the whole thing that what I've talked about is summarized in this. So finally, good luck to all of you. I'm sure you'll do a good job by all these methods, all these things. And that is it, that if it is not luck really, but more skill, more information, more awareness, more method, and finally, more care. So you too can consistently get this result most of the time as you do your total hips. And that would give you great pleasure, apart from the patient getting a great result and sending more patients to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Excellent presentation, sir. And it is very informative, not for the beginner, but also the experienced person too. So, now open for question, panelists.
So there is one question in chat box. How much overhang is permissible on the posterior superior aspect?
It's a 20% overlap for the pinnacle because it's a very hemispherical thing. But for others, not preferably avoid the overhang.
Sir, I have a question. You showed a X-ray where the acetabulum was closed. And you actually said that there won't be any problem in such close acetabulum as well. But what I feel that in the long run, because of the overhang, these they get loosened because of repeated trauma during abduction. So any comment on that?
Yes, actually what happened was that the surgeon, I had a talk with the surgeon also. And the whole thing was that they got a very good fixation. The surgeon was myself, just to make it clear. So when I looked at the X-ray, I was there. But the one thing was that I did get a very good stable position on that. And certain cases happens that you may have to place it a little closed because that is much better than keeping it open. The chances of dislocation is more. We have seen cases, 10, 12 year follow-ups with this amount of exposure or uncoverage. But the interesting thing is that when you look at the uncemented hip history, it requires only a 20% bonding to make it stable and good. So it's not that I'm saying that you should do this, that happened, but it happens. And even if it does, the main thing is that, have you got a good fit, tight, good fit? And that is more important than a lot of other things.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Nishikant has raised, yes.
Yes. I think regarding the coverage, I think you should get at least 70% coverage of the cup to get a good stability. An important thing is to, you should prevent the impingement. If your cup is overhanged, one third cup is overhanged and your GT is impinging over the cup, then there is always a high risk of dislocation and instability is there. You have to look all these aspects clearly.
Yes. It's ideal would be for the pinnacle about a 20%, for the others totally in. And every place, every operation that is done, at the end of it, the surgeon moves the hip around.
Yes, that's very important.
And that's important to see whether it is impinging on.
And one more thing, I think we should never hesitate in doing a cemented hip, cemented stabilum as well. If there's anything you are finding this impinging, there's not stability, you always go ahead with the cemented cup.
Absolutely. I'm a great believer in the cemented cup because of one thing. The one thing is that you can change the version as you want. You can change the femoral version as you want.
Yes.
And that you can't do in an uncemented area. Once it's gone, it's gone. And once if you try and take it out, is loosened and the whole thing doesn't fit in as well as it does.
But you need to know how the cementing is being done. That's the most important aspect. Absolutely.
Exact technique, I think. You should know how to cement it.
The cementing technique is very important. And you have to know the exact ways of how to use the cement and what time.
Yes.
Sir, I have one question. Regarding cemented and uncemented cups. Sir, what is your experience of doing cemented cups in young patients? For example, 40 years old or 45 years old. Because a lot of surgeons are, I know a lot of surgeons in Delhi who are doing cemented cups in young patients as well. So is there any difference between cemented and uncemented in young patients? I mean, do uncemented cups actually have a better take up than cemented cups? Is there any difference between the two?
Cemented cups in the history of young patients, whatever literature we have, hasn't worked too well. That's why the acetabular component is a problem with the cemented cups. The femoral ones, the excita ones, goes years on end. 30 years, 40 years follow-ups are there. But the acetabular cup has a greater degree of loosening in young patients. In the older patients, of course, it doesn't matter. Now, that's why the hybrid came in. The acetabular uncemented and the femoral side cemented. Now, they also can do a reverse hybrid, but the idea is to, the hybrid came in because of that, because the cemented cups were failing. And so they did an uncemented cup on the acetabulum and a femoral stem. I would hesitate to do a femoral cemented hip in a young patient because the uncemented cups give such great results. Once it's in, once everything is settled, we have follow-ups of over 15 to 20 years in our own hands, let alone the literature. And that has given us more confidence. And especially the uncemented cups nowadays are so good and so weird that we don't even hesitate in giving them weight bearing earlier. Previously, it was thought 6 weeks to let them osseointegrate, etc. But now we give it earlier on, and there has been no problem in this uncemented cup. But the uncemented cup has to be, as we discussed, has to be done well. And the cemented cup would be my thing if there is a, for the femoral side at least, if there is that Dor C type. And if in the acetabular side also, a cemented cup in the older patients is not bad.
So, Nishikant, you want to add something here?
Yeah, I have been trained under Professor Ross. So he's a great proponent of cemented hips in young adults. And he has published a lot of literature regarding this as well. If you look at the literature from the Exeter as well, they recommend up to 35 to 40 years follow-up of a patient doing well over the cemented turtle hips. But I totally agree with you, sir. Doing a hybrid is more beneficial in younger patients. So I would always go with the uncemented cup and the excita stem over the femoral side. And if you, even if you have to revise that, there is always cement on cement revision option is available there. So that's a good option. You can conserve the bone and give a bit better results to the patients.
That's right. I know Ross is a great propagator of that and he's a great guy. Yes, but cemented is, I love cemented in certain cases where I wouldn't do anything of the uncemented exactly. You're absolutely right.
And so one more comment regarding weight bearing in uncemented cups. I was also, I did a fellowship in Australia, Adelaide, in Sportsmed. So the surgeon under whom I was trained, Tony Spriggins, he would say that, and he would start immediate weight bearing after uncemented cups also. And his take was that the more compression, the more weight you give, as it gives a little more compression and it's better for osteointegration. So what's your take on that?
I think initially when the uncemented cups used to come in, I'm not sure about the coating part of it, but the recommendation was initially that you do a partial weight bearing for 6 weeks and then go, allowing it for osseointegration. But nowadays with these improved cups and the improved coatings that are there, it is not necessary. We don't now give delayed weight bearing. We put them up as quickly as possible. About the compression part of it, okay. But if you have got a good tight fit, there is no further compression with the body weight.
So there is one question in chat box. When you call it a closed cup and when you call it an open cup, so what is your reference for that?
Yeah, the closed cup, if you go by the angles of it, if you're doing by the 45 degree angle, then give or take plus minus 10 below. So if the angle is less than that, that will be a closed cup. If, you know, going below the 45 would be a closed cup and going above would be a more vertical cup. Now the closed cup portion of it, as we said, there are certain areas in which you may have deliberately to give a closed cup for the maximum stability. It is not sacrosanct that you have to go 45 all the time. There will be areas where the surgeon will give it a little bit close to get a good stable hip.
I think we have completed all the questions. Govind, we can go with our next talk.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, Nishikant. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, you are audible.
Oh, my slides are visible?
Yes.
Okay. So, thanks a lot for inviting me. I would like to thank Rajiv Raman sir and the Jharkhand Orthopedic Association for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. Jharkhand has been very close to my heart. I have spent first 5 years of my life in Jharkhand. My son used to live in Bokaro. So my topic is instability in total hip arthroplasty. So there are very few lectures which start with the take-home message, but mine will. My take-home message would be, decisions are more important than incisions. And this holds true in cases of total hip arthroplasty. As we all know, total hip arthroplasty has been declared operation of the century, but it is not far from complications. These dislocations or instability are psychologically traumatic to the patient and surgeons. It is, in fact, the worst nightmare any surgeon can have. So instability is the second most common complication after aseptic loosening. The rates vary from 0.5 to 10%. There are two terms, subluxation and dislocation. Subluxation is a painless clunk leading to instability and pain, while dislocation is complete subluxation and an intervention is required to relocate the hip. So coming on to factors leading to instability, it can be grouped into patient-related factor or the surgeon-related factor. Among the patient-related factor, increasing age, female sex, tall height, any previous surgery or neuromuscular impairment, all these lead to increased risk of instability. Among the surgeon-related factor, surgical approach, the component orientation, the choice of implant, soft tissue tension, leg length offset, and experience of the surgeon matters. I will discuss each one of them. Coming on to surgical approach. Surgical approach being a risk factor is highly controversial. If you look at the literature, most literature suggests that there's increased risk of dislocation with the posterior approach. But I am a posterior approach surgeon, and what we have just developed, we used to cut the capsule and the externorotators in a single piece. And we used to repair this myocapsule, and this has decreased the risk of dislocation to almost nil. So you need to repair your capsule and the muscles altogether. So component orientation, as already discussed, it is the most crucial factor. You need to place your components correctly within the safe zone. The safe zone for stable component is between 35 to 45 degree of abduction and 15 to 25 degree of antiversion. So you need to place your cup in well inclination and well antiverted. You need to maintain the limb length, need to maintain the offset. All these three things has to be accurate to get a good, stable, total hip arthroplasty. So as already discussed, I used to guide my cup according to the transverse acetabular ligament and anterior wall. For me, transverse acetabular ligament is a guide for inclination and anterior wall is a guide for antiversion. I used to put my cup just inside the tal to be well inclined and just inside the anterior wall to be well antiverted. So Ranawat has given the concept of combined antiversion or the coplanar. What is this? So after putting the trial components, you need to put your hip in 10 degree of flexion and 10 degree of adduction. And the amount of internal rotation required for this head to be coplanar with the shell is the combined antiversion. This should be between 30 to 45 degree. So the antiversion of the cup is not important. The combined antiversion is more important. So offset, it can be vertical offset or the horizontal offset. Vertical offset can be increased by using modular neck, but if you increase the neck's length, your limb length will be inadequate or it may increase. Horizontal offset, if inadequate, leads to increased joint reaction force and dislocation. So how can you increase the horizontal offset? By increasing the leg length or decreasing the neck shaft angle. So how to maintain or know the limb length and offset? Ranawat had developed this technique. You put a Stingman pin in the infracotyloid groove and marking is made over the trochanter and the saddle of the neck. Then after you dislocate the hip, you mark, this mark is made over the center of the head. From this distance, center of the head to the lesser trochanter gives an idea of the limb length. From this center of the head to the greater trochanter gives an idea of the offset. After putting the trial components, you can again compare with the preoperative debuffs whether you have achieved your limb length or not and whether you have achieved your offset or not. Again, you need to check after putting your components, again put the Stingman pin inside, and then you can again measure whether you have adequately achieved your limb length or not. So Exeter have developed a different technique. What they used to do, they used to put a pin over the trochanteric tip. And from that trochanteric tip, they used to measure this distance from this to the saddle of the neck. This is the, and in the preoperative radiograph, they used to measure this length and they try to reciprocate. This kind of a variation we need to put into the postoperative picture. So this method can be used as well. So hip dislocation can be of three types. It can be because of intraprosthetic impingement, it can be because of intraosseous impingement, or because of spontaneous dislocations. So before proceeding to management, we need to diagnose whether it is early or late instability, whether it is any traumatic event or not, whether it is anterior or posterior dislocation, what is the component relationship. So most of the cause for early dislocation is an inadequate soft tissue tension, component malposition, infections. And late causes mostly occur because of polyvia. So you need to see your radiograph correctly. You need to know what's the inclination of your cup, what's the offset of the cup, what's the offset of the stem, what's the height of the center of hip, what's the antiversion. So you need to assess your cup positioning before managing this kind of instability. So management can be either conservative or surgical. Conservative closed reduction is done under GA, but you need to determine the safe range of, if you reduce the hip closely, and you need to know whether the hip is stable under the safe range of motion or not. If it is not stable, you need to revise it. The method of immobilization can be hip brace, and the period of immobilization are, according to DOR, from 4 to 6 weeks. So indication of surgery, mostly if it is more than two dislocations, chronic dislocation, there's any malposition components or there's inadequate soft tissue tensions. So there are different surgical methods. I will discuss each one of them. So if the component is positioned away from the safe zone, you need to revise it. The component positions are, if the acetabular component is more medialized, increased chances of impingement of the pelvis. The height of hip is high. it is more than 35 millimeter above the center inter teardrop line, the increased risk of dislocation is there. So you need to look all these aspects. And if the components are away from the safe zone, you need to revise the gap. And only the conservative methods are not going to give you better results in this. The soft tissue augmentation can be done by using long modular neck, trochanteric advancement, or using a large diameter of the head. So large, as you increase the size of the head, the range of motion increases and the jump distance increases. So the range of motion increases and the risk of dislocation decreases. But as you increase the size of the head, the size of the poly decreases. So the chances of wear are higher. So for me, the normal size of the head is 32. You can use the modular neck, so they can better adapt the offset, leg length, and version. But there are, this is not far from complications. It may lead to aseptic loosening and neck fractures. Impingement can be intraprosthetic or intraosseous. After putting your cup inside, you need to remove all the impinging osteophytes, mostly from the anterior and the inferior aspect. In posterior approach, you need to keep the posterior osteophytes intact. So these are the tests of impingement. So any loss of abduction function is there. You can do the trochanteric advancement or the facial arthroplasty is there. So this is the new thing, the dual mobility cup, which is called tripolar unconstrained. It is based on the principle of encasement of the regular size femoral head component inside a large size of poly liner by the snap fit mechanism, which in turn articulates with and moves within a metallic shell fixed to the stubular bone. So effectively, it increases the jump distance and the rate of dislocation has decreased. So primary indication is primary hips, where there's increased risk of dislocations, or any revision hips with instability. But this is not far from complications as well. If you reduce these dual mobility cups, you can see that the snap fit mechanism gets distorted and the poly is lying over here. We call it bubble sign. So this is a case of 10-year-old trochanteric arthroplasty, recurrent instability is there, revised it with dual mobility cup. This is another case of a fractured neck femur with shaft. Someone has done this nailing. The neck went to non-union. Someone has revised it by putting exchange nail and putting free screws into the neck and using muscle pedicle bone grafting. The shaft went on to uniting, but there's avian and secondary OA of the hip. So the patient came to me with this kind of x-rays, had to revise it, used this kind of construct, went on to dislocating in the first week, reduced closely, again dislocated, again reduced. This is the third episode. So what's the option right now? So I opened it. All the components were correctly placed, whether it's cup or the stem. What I found, there was weakness of the abductors, the medius part, which was the nail was inserted through the trochanteric tip. So there was loosening of the soft tissue tension was there. So what I did, this is a striker cup and the stem is of Corel. So I just removed the poly and converted it into dual mobility cup. So this is the construct I made. So just remove the poly, put it in the dual mobility type of stem and type of construct inside, and the hip is stable. This is a 2-year follow-up. So this is another indication is the revision hips. Then another case of aseptic loosening of this bipolar, had to revise it, put a Wagner's tape, and I've used the cemented dual mobility cup. It was 70 years old female, so had to use the dual mobility cup, and I used the cemented dual mobility cup. Another indication is the failed fixation. These kind of failed fixation of the proximal femur. The plate was put and it went on to non-union, multiple attempts of eradicating the infection has been made already. So had to revise it, put a Wagner stem and the uncemented dual mobility cup. So another thing is in these kind of instabilities, the bioball. These bioball are neck adapters, so which can increase the offset and the version. So these are used in certain cases where you need to increase the offset, where you've already used the largest diameter of the neck, and still you're not able to achieve the adequate stability, and you want to increase the offset and the version, you can use this kind of new construct called bioball. This comes from a German company called Merit. So this is a case of a 70-year-old female who has been done ASR for fractured neck femur, subsequently went on to develop very positive fracture. The solution stem was used with a Duraloc cup. Solution stems are famous for subsiding. So this stem subsided and hip went on to dislocating. You can see that this is the largest diameter of the head has already been used. So what's the option now? So the surgeon has put constant poly over there. Again, it went on to dislodgement. So what's the option left? Revising a solution stem is a hell of a job. You need to remove the each and every part of the bone there. So what we have done, we have just put in bioball there. And this went on to uniting and a stable hip was there. Another case of a 60-year-old female male with a solution stem inside. Again, the solution stem subsided and went on to subluxation shaping. The largest diameter of the neck was already used, so had to use this bioball construct there. So the last thing is the constant manner. So indications are the patient who has a well-positioned and well-fixed components, but it still has instability. Any abductor deficiencies there or in the elderly patient. So this should be the last option. So another case of the stubular fractures, multiple attempts of the fixation has been done. I don't know where the screws are. So came to some other surgeon. They have used this cage construct and the cemented stem is there. Subsequently, you can see there's a loosening over the cup as well and patient developed dislocating. Patient has become a habitual dislocator. He has dislocated around 50 times. So came to me for a revision. This is the CT scan. So as I removed it, I can find the large defect was there, the superlateral aspect. I had to use the augment and used a constant cup there. And the stem was also taken out in the course of exposure, had to do a cement on cement revision over the stem side. So this is the construct, this is the 5-year follow-up. So the girdle stone dissection is the last resort. So the conclusion would be the unstable hip, if the components are malpositioned, you need to revise it. The components are correctly placed. If there's impingement, you can get rid of by using large head. You can use the elevated poly. If there is wear, you need to change the poly. If there's abductor dysfunction, you can use the longer neck. You can use the trochaetic advancement. You can use the large head or the diplopic cup. And the last resort is the constant liner. So the risk of dislocation can be minimized by proper surgical technique and preoperative planning. Close reduction has been successful in most of the cases. You should always try the conservative management the first. If not, then you can revise the bulk portion component. Even if you are not successful, you go for the large diameter femoral head, remove impingement, or the diplopic cuff. Even if all these are not successful, you can go for the constant liner. Thanks a lot for your patient hearing.
Wonderful presentation, Dr. Nishikant. One question, in your one case, there was 3 attempts of dislocation and you attempted to reduce it. And,
yes.
And you come to know that there is an abductor weakness. So how do you come to the conclusion that there is an abductor weakness?
After opening it, after 2 dislocations, after in fact 3 dislocations, we decided that it's not going to stay by doing the conservative methods. We need to revise it. So while opening it, we saw that the abductor strength, the abductor soft tissue tension was not adequate there because the nail was inserted through the trochanteric tip so that the insertion point of the medius was disturbed.
Okay.
So at the components were well fixed. The cup was well fixed. The stem was well fixed. So we had to discuss whether we need to revise all the components or we can do something else. So what we did, we just take out the poly, converted it into a dual multi cup. So we didn't need to remove the well fixed cup on the stem.
Okay.
Luckily, it was a striker cup.
Yeah.
I have one question.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Rohit.
Because you found out that there was only abductor mechanism disturbance. Couldn't you have done just a trochanteric advancement in such cases?
Can be done. But there's always a risk of non-union in these cases.
Dr. Nishikant, excellent presentation. Sometimes you see after reduction, when you are seeing for the final movement, you see there's some amount of instability in terminal range of motion, terminal flexion, terminal external rotation. So how do you immobilize the limb in those cases?
I'm not able to get you, sir.
Yeah. So sometimes you get instability in terminal external rotation or terminal flexion and abduction and external rotation.
You mean to ask in the while doing the primary hips or while doing
primary hips.
So if you are getting instability in the terminal range of motion, you need to change the version. So it depends whether you are doing your cup first or the stem first. If you have already done with your cup and you are seeing you put your trial into the stem and you are seeing that your range of motion is not complete or the hip is dislocating if you move it in the anterior direction, you need to give it more antiverted. So you can always convert it to the cemented type of stem where you can always change your version. You always have that version. So you need to put the trial component first, give it a trial whether your hip is stable or not. If you're not satisfied with it, go and change the version of the stem.
Sadar sir, you want to add something?
No, I thought it was a great presentation and lots of the very difficult situations and very innovative solutions. Usage of these bioballs, etc., it sounds good and it has worked well for 4 or 5 years, but it changes the biomechanics of the hip. Mm. And maybe the greater find some other problems later on of pain, etc. But so far, a very difficult problem and very well solved.
Sardar sir, I have one question. What is your experience about dual mobility cups? Nishikant is doing it, but I want your view also on it.
I think dual mobility cups are here to stay. It helps you in very difficult situations. But again, as he has shown, the dual mobility cup can also dislocate. And the dual mobility cup also has other problems in pain arising in certain cases. It's not a solve-all situation, but in certain cases, it's the best solution that can have. Because once dual mobility cups have come in, a lot of difficult cases have been made simpler.
So what are the cases where you would want to do a dual mobility cup in revisions?
Especially these cases where there is dislocation, and especially the cases where the reconstruction of the acetabulum would employ a very big sort of implant, etc. Either a big cage, big this. But in those cases, a dual mobility cup can be a much safer solution.
One thing, dual mobilities are not only indicated in revisions. We are doing dual mobility in the primaries as well. For instance, you can use this in fresh fractured neck femur, where there's the increased risk of dislocation is there. Most people say in the West are doing dual mobility cup in the fresh fractured neck femur in the S group patients.
Yes, it's expensive.
Expensive, yes, sir, expensive. But the cheaper variants are always available here. Evolutus has a much cheaper. Evolutus has much cheaper variant. And the important thing is they have got the cemented dual mobility variant as well. So that's a very good innovation, I think.
Yes, Rakesh.
Unmute.
Sir, these days, what's the take upon the Ayushman Bharat, the cases done under Ayushman Bharat, where cheaper THRs are being used? What's your view?
Indian implant, you are.
Yeah. Being done right in centers which are not well equipped with for the THR, and how does this
now thing is being frequently used?
Yeah.
What's your take?
You can always use the cemented variant in these cases, I think, and the cemented THR. The cost will be cheaper, and you can give a good results in those cases as well.
No, the hospital where I work, it's not implanted in the Ayushman. I'm just asking an overall overview. The current scenario with the advent of this Ayushman Bharat scheme, because a lot of patients have become eligible for getting THR done under this scheme in less equipped centers and with these cheaper implants available.
I think you need to discuss with the patient because we need to make them understand that if they want the implant which is lasting longer than their life, they need to invest something. That is not in the package, they need to invest it.
Correct. That is, you have to, in fact, even in Ayushman Bharat, they have these option now where you can use better implants and uncemented hips.
But you can't charge. Because
the implants charge, now they have separated from the package. I'm not doing replacement in Ayushman, but there are a lot of surgeons who say
legally, that. Legally, you can't get extra money from the patient.
Yes.
Otherwise, you will be in hell.
I think, can I ask one question to Sadar, sir?
Yeah.
Regarding this spinopelvic abnormality, so this is a newer concept evolving everywhere. So where you want to put your cup in a kyphotic deformity in the spine, and then and where you want to put a cup in the lordotic spine? So there, I think there should be a message for the audience as well.
Yes. Generally speaking, in a kyphotic spine, there happens an ankylosing spondylitis. You have to put it in a more antiversion.
Yes.
And in lordosis, you have to go a little bit retroverted on it. That's why the two varieties of lateral view x-rays of the sitting and the standing position is important.
And does it matter whether it is a rigid spine or a flexible spine?
In a flexible spine, it doesn't matter that much because okay. The pelvic obliquity is not that much. But in a fixed spine, like ankylosing, it has been there for quite some time and the pelvic has become fixed in that position also, which means that the acetabulum, by dint of the movements that are happening consistently, the acetabulum has also changed a bit.
And where will you advise the patient to go to undergo the spinal surgery first and then come for the hip surgery?
Yes, that is a very important thing. This decision I would take with the opinion of the spinal surgeon. It is not okay. Mine. I would refer it to a spinal surgeon and I'll discuss it with him. And most of the cases, we have very good spinal surgeons who will say that spinal surgery is not going to improve the situation to that extent. So you go ahead with your hip surgery or knee surgery. And this happens more in knee surgery, really. And then we can do something about the spine later on. Or maybe they'll say, I want to do it right now, and then you do it later. And that is an area which requires a very great consultation on this. But definitely the other areas where if there is a neurological problem. You see, in a neurological problem, I'd always eliminate the spinal thing first before I go into a hip thing or anything, whatever.
That's a very important take-home message, I think.
Yes.
Nishikant, for unstable hip, suppose you're getting a patient of unstable hip, so what are your diagnostic protocol? What are the investigation you suggest?
Sorry?
For unstable hip, what are the investigation you will suggest?
So first of all, you need to assess the x-rays. The pre-op x-rays, they're starting from the pre-op x-rays, you need to understand whether the cup was positioned correctly in the first instance. Then you need to know whether it is stable or not. So regarding investigation, the x-ray, and I always advise CT in these cases. So you need to get an idea of whether there's any defect or not, whether there's any sign of loosening or not. But you need to always rule out the infection as well in these cases, whether there is any incipient infection or not. So you always the blood parameters, that these are all the fancy markers, that D-dimers and all, interleukin 6, you can always order them. But the CT scan, x-rays, the blood parameters, and apart from them, that to rule out the neurological issues. You can always get consultation from the neurological side or the NCDs. So these are the investigation you can always give to the patients.
There's a question in chat box. Suppose you have relocated a dislocated hip. So how would you immobilize? A boomstick cluster or just a knee brace?
So that is very important. When you do the close reduction of the hip, the only the reduction is not important. You need to assess whether the hip is stable or not in the safe range of motion. So when the patient is under GA, you need to move your hip in the abduction, adduction, and the rotation. If the hip is not stable in the safe range of motion, that is that hip is not going to stay. Whatever you do the immobilization, for how long you do, that is going to dislocate again. So if the hip is stable, say for the 22 degree of abduction, 20 degree of adduction and the rotation, I always do a boot cast.
All right.
And for the 4 weeks, I used to do.
Sadar sir, how do you immobilize this hip? Relocated hip?
Yeah, I use one of the things that when I'm not very confident of the patient, I'd give a broomstick cluster. That will really immobilize it in abduction for quite some time. I have to be sure that it is not dislocated. So one is a broomstick cluster. The other is, if it's not that great, I'll put them in an abduction pillow. that's available and that's easy to do and that they can take home and use for quite some time. But these are the two things which I will ensure a proper hip abduction on these cases for quite some time.
So I have one comment on this. If the hip is dislocating immediately after the surgery, so then probably the acetabular cup is not placed properly, or maybe the anteversion of the head is not proper. So will close reduction actually help in these cases?
Actually not.
Because then you would want to revise the cup, and if one feels that the cup is okay, then maybe revising the stem with giving a greater anteversion or getting a proud stem, all these things, perhaps you get out of the instability. But doing a close reduction and doing it for 4 weeks, does it help? I mean, it's my question.
That's the last thing I would want from my patient, to be immobilized after doing a totally partial class. That's the last.
Correct.
Yeah, there's one thing about it. Not all dislocations are due to malposition.
The soft tissue training, yes.
Especially during transport, putting them into bed. If you have seen some of the ways untrained persons do, and you are lucky that they stay in the reduced position. So if that is the situation and that is the thing, then this closed reduction helps. It really helps, because I'm sure we've all had experiences in which you've done a single closed reduction and the patients have stayed on for years on end after that.
And regarding the cup placement, I think that the two situations are very commonly encountered in our part of the world, the protusio hips and the dysplastic hips. The two hips are the most commonly everybody must be seeing. So how will you manage the rimming in these two different cases, the protusio hips and dysplastic hips? How your rimming is different in these two cases, sir? Sardar, sir.
The protrusio hip is one of the cases where we generally try to find the best possible, the original acetabulum, and that is shallow. So if it is shallow, then the question comes in, how much to ream, how much to medialize. Mm. And it is these cases that the bantam cups really come in, because in some of these cases, it can. But I'm a great believer in cemented hips in these cases. And I will use it, and I have follow-ups of almost 12 years, 14 years follow-up in which we've done this. And one of the systems that we use is, instead of doing a stochantric shortening osteotomy, obviously that has to be done in certain cases. But in those cases, I use a procedure in which I erase the glutei muscle from the iliac crest. Just erase, no cutting. And during that eraser, I'm able to bring down the femur quite a lot for the reduction. And once you allow this to settle, it finds its own attachment. And the abduction power is decent enough, adequate enough for them to survive. The other thing is that in some of these cases, one of the systems that I use, in which has fallen into the not in practice, is a traction LLD. Once you use a traction and do an X-ray, you are able to find out, especially under anesthesia, is how much you're able to bring down without just on the muscular part of it, on the soft tissue part of it, without cutting bone. And if that is adequate, you don't need to go for the bone cut. And if that also is not much, then you obviously have to do the subtrochanteric osteotomy. As for the reaming part, I have to be very careful on the medial side. There was this thing of a controlled breakage of the acetabular site, which was used.
Cotyloplasty.
Yeah, cotyloplasty. But it's very difficult to control that. So I would use it and deepen it as much as possible to get in a cup of an adequate size. And the reason why a cemented cup is so much better in these cases.
Your experience with the PSL cup, sir?
I haven't really used that PSL cup. But because nowadays we find these cases of a DDH not that much coming in private practice. So I haven't used that in these situations.
I have used the PSL cups in mostly the proteasal hips, where we don't want to put the cup inside. I just want to take the puncture over the periphery. So in these situations, I think the proteasal hips, the PSL cups are a boon.
Yeah, in the protrusio hips, yes. In the protrusio hips, however, the protrusio part of it is carefully reamed. And you're quite right, a rim fitting cup, that will help a lot. That will help, that helps a lot. But in the protrusio, you have to be careful about the base part of it, because you just don't go reaming blindly. And recognize the protrusio, recognize it. And then in certain cases, you can put your bone grafts in, a reverse ream and the standard stuff of doing the game. But in those cases, the uncemented cup, because in this protrusio, the superolateral part is not bad. So in those cases, if you can get a rim fit uncemented cup with two screws in there, that gives a good result, a long-term good results. But the base, I would put in a graft and reverse ream and then push in the uncemented cup with the screws.
Okay. I think we can go with case presentation, Govind.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Dr. Rohit.
Yeah, I'll present my case. Can I start sharing my screen?
Yeah.
So am I audible?
Yes.
So I just taking the discussion further. This is a case I did a year ago, and I managed it somehow. But I would want comments from the experts about this case. So this is a 30-year-old female, waddling gait, restricted abduction. She had a long history of hip deformity and hip problem. And this was her X-ray. So on the left side is a DDH, adult DDH. And on the right side also adult DDH. And coming to the Crow's classification, we classified it as
Yes, Dr. Nishikant.
Hello.
So this was the classification, Crow's classification, and it was classified as grade 3, type 3 Crow, where it was not a very high hip, but it was completely dislocated. So we tackled the left hip first. And Crow type 1 in right and type 3 in left. Did the left fit first. She had more, because she had more problem in the left, and we wanted to achieve a limb length correction and accordingly do the right hip. So I did a posterior approach because I'm able to get better exposure through posterior approach. We had difficulty in finding the true acetabulum, but we carefully dissected all the pulvinar tissues, capsule, everything was excised. And on the femoral side, there was a lot of antiversion. Antiversion is more in such cases, and the trochanter is malformed. We did a cemented cup, Depew Johnson & Johnson, and an uncemented stem of Pitcairn because of cost issues. So we were able to find the true acetabulum. And this is the acetabulum, true acetabulum, which is being reamed. And this was the shortening. Had to do a little bit of capsular release and tenotomy of iliopsoas to get the reduction. And this was what we achieved in the left hip. Subsequently, there was a little bit of, she had a mild foot drop also after the surgery, but that recovered. And then we did, after 7 months, we did the right hip. This is the right hip. So right hip was okay because acetabulum was all right, but the only problem in right hip was the stem was very narrow. So we used the C stem, which also Depew Johnson & Johnson cemented size. And this is what we were able to achieve on the right side. Both the hips were very stable and the patient was allowed to walk the very next day after her right surgery. She's able to bear. So all these DDH cases are very demanding. We have to identify the problem. So, and you have to have the courage to do such surgeries, and you have to give time during surgery, and then you'll come out with flying colors. Thank you. So any comment on how to approach these patients? And...
Yes. Excellent surgery done. Excellent surgery done, Dr. Roy. Commendable
Thank
job.
You. Thank you.
Just one issue, I think if you just focus
on... Dr. Nishikant, excuse me. Actually, my case is also based on that. So should I present my case to and start the discussion?
Yeah, all it.
Yeah.
It would be better, I think.
Yeah, I'll stop sharing now. Okay.
So because coincidentally, I also prepared a slide on the DDH.
DDH, yeah.
So I think discussion would be better if both the cases are finished. Share screen. Wait. So, is it there?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Again, this is a middle-aged lady, around 35 to 40 years in between. She had a history, long history of limping for about 20 years or so. And this is her X-ray. And this is, sorry.
Just click on the screen. Click on the screen.
Yes, just me. Okay, so this is a lateral view, and according to classification, it is almost gross three, type three, and this is a CT scan. Wanted to see the acetabulum and the head. So we can have discussion with this thing. Sir, Sardar sir.
I think you first go ahead with your presentation, then we can discuss over
okay.
this.
Yeah. Okay, fine. So I went ahead with the supine, this anterolateral approach, modified hard hinge. This is the kind of head I got it. And my plan included the acetabulum cup and the acetabulum stem and the ventrum cup. So there was very little much of a head was there. And acetabulums are very much a bone preserving surgery. So a very less amount of bone could be removed from the neck side. And there was a lot of superior defect in the acetabulum. So I used a bone graft from the head and put it on the superior side, fix it with two screws. And reaming was done up to, I think, 44, and 46 cup was used. subtrochanteric osteotomy was done to reduce the head into the cup. This is a trial. This cup positioning. This was way done in 2018. So this all are the things which was available with me right now. There's a reduction with final placement of the components. Around 2 centimeters of bone was removed, I hope so, 2.5 centimeter. The shortening was around 6 centimeter, and final shortening was around 3 centimeter. So the sleeve is made up of the bone which we removed from the subtrochanteric osteotomy. And this is the final picture. This is the first post-op picture. This is around 2 months follow-up. This is the final shortening. This I got around, I think, I don't remember the date, but it was almost 1 year later. Almost so. I'll show you just a video, walking video. There's still some shortening. I had advised a heel raise for her, but she wasn't using it. She was happy without that only. So that's also. So now it's almost 3 years. Yesterday I had talked with that lady. She was busy in some function, so she couldn't send me the first x-rays and the video. But they are happy. They are not having any complaint. They stay in Godda district, my home district.
So excellent surgery done, Dr. Rakesh. Excellent surgery.
Thank you.
Very well done. Very well done. Absolutely. So why have you used the SROM stem? You could have easily come up with the cemented variant as well.
I was quite skeptical, actually. This was the first kind of case which I was exposed to. So to be on safer side, SROM gives us better.
I hope it's more, cemented stems are more forgiving.
Well, I went ahead with this plan, and I was happy with it.
Yeah, SROM, I think, gave you the good amount of version.
Yeah.
You can control.
You have a greater safety margin with the SROM.
Yes. The other thing about the approach, these are the sort of cases I've always felt that...
Posterior approach.
No, not only posterior approach. I was wanting the original Chanley. The trochanteric approach.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would, give you a very good exposure. And once you remove the tight abductors through the bone, your traction, etc., would come in much simpler. So you may have to do a subtrochanteric shortening osteotomy, but that would be countermanded by your lateralization of the trochanter, and which will give you better abductor power.
Yes, sir. Any tip and tricks to deal with this high hip center? Most of the dysplastic hip, your hip center is very high. So how do you plan? So whether I will go for a just muscle slide or a femoral shortening. So how do you plan, and how does it help? And what are the factors this helps you in planning, sir?
Yeah, the slide is one of the things that previously is to do is traction LLD. Now, once that traction LLD and see how much it can be reduced, will give you an idea of the soft tissue loosening that can take place. The second is that in all cases, we can do that after the slide operation. That will also give you some things. And the last resort is doing the subtrochanteric osteotomy. the subtrochanteric osteotomy is that then you'll have to face a trial and then bring the thing down and see how much length that you have to cut really. Because the subtrochanteric osteotomy in one way is the best way of avoiding ascitic nerve palsy.
Yes.
I have one thing. When you're doing a subtrochanteric osteotomy, there is a technique where you cut a step cut osteotomy. And when you're doing that step cut osteotomy, you have to use a uncemented stem, in my view, because a cemented stem will not help in union. So do a step cut kind of an osteotomy and then fix your stem. Then I think you don't even require to put all these wires and all these things. What is your say on this, Sardar sir?
I'm not sure about the step cut thing. I think the current trend is to go for an excision of a piece of bone.
Yes, a transverse cut.
Step cut was done before. It had its uses, but it had its problems also.
Yes.
So because you need an additional wire over that area or something to keep it there. And then the whole thing is so narrow that keeping an uncemented stem may not always be a feasible option. So if you do a transverse, you have the option of doing a narrow cemented stem, like the C-stem that you used. That will also be a good idea of that.
Can we have the Dr. Rohit's post-op X-ray? Dr. Rohit, can you just show your post-op X-ray?
Yeah. Pelvis and both hip, that X-ray. Yeah.
I'll share my screen now.
By that time, Dr. Nishikant, how do you decide on your femoral stem? So that is very important in DDH. So what stem we will use?
Normally, my preference is doing the cemented variant in these DDHFs because I can change my version accordingly, according to my wish. I can deepen it. I can make it broad, totally according to my wish. I am aware my hip is stable.
So this is the final X-ray, actually.
Can you just zoom in? Slides here?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
So what I was just wondering, there's still some flexion deformities left over the left side. There is
definitely some flaw in the. But I think the wire broke, so we cannot tell exactly what is the inclination of this cup. But we were very happy at the intra-op. We were very happy with the inclination and stability of the hip joint.
One of the toughest cases it has. Like the hip is.
Get it down was, we were ready with subtrochanteric osteotomy also, but fortunately in this case we were able to manage with a bit of release because all these DDH hips, the muscle and muscles are not so much contracted. I don't know what is the reason, maybe because they are very lax. So the muscles are not very contracted. So with a little bit of release, one can get the stem in the acetabulum.
So what I'm just wondering, you are having the cup inclined up to about 45 to 50 degrees. The inclination is around 45 to 50 degrees. You could have bring it down by using a mesh and doing impaction bone grafting over there.
Yeah, that could have been done. Yes, definitely. But we were happy with the medial wall. So everything we were seeing radiologically also. So I was using my image while doing this case on the left side. So
excellent. It's one of the toughest cases regarding hips.
We were doing it very slowly and we were very careful in this case. Although there was a little bit of foot drop, but it recovered in another two or three months. She recovered of the foot drop.
Wait, please share your pre-op X-ray.
Yeah, definitely. So, yeah, this was the
Sardar sir. One question for the beginners: in left side, there is. Please say about your tips and tricks how to reach the acetabulum, true acetabulum.
Yeah.
during surgery.
No, the true acetabulum has to be found out. This is where you have to expose it properly. You have to cut off that head portion of it, and then that will give you the more. Yeah. And again, I say emphasize on the traction part of it. And if you can give a traction on it, then you can go down below. Now, how do you find out which is a true acetabulum? That thing would be going by the pulvinar, by the soft tissue. Usually in some of these cases, there is some remnant of a ligamentum teres, which will lead you into the true acetabulum part of it also. And even if that is not there, then you have to use a CRM to see exactly where you are. And here again, the teardrop plays a part. The teardrop is there. You put your thing, you go from the teardrop upwards. And that will give you a good idea about where your acetabulum is. And this is in this case, it was very necessary to do the true acetabulum finding, because it's a bilateral case which he was going to do. And you have to place it in the proper den to get all the both the centers of hip rotation on the same line.
Yes, sir.
I have seen few people putting this acetabulum at the false acetabulum side itself. So what's
high
the
hip center?
High hip. Yeah.
Not in this case.
Not for this case, but I have seen few X-rays where they go.
They have. In the cases where there is a very good, false acetabulum, it almost looks like the true acetabulum. Hmm. But in those cases, usually they're bilateral. And if you have this sort of case, you won't do it in the false acetabulum. In a bilateral case, both well-formed false acetabulums, that's an area where you can think of doing. But my main emphasis would be always to find out the true thing and bring everything down. And if that involves doing a subtrochanteric osteotomy, if that involves doing a gluteal release of the, that involves doing a trochanteric osteotomy, whatever, but I'll try and bring it down below. But that is the best survival of the whole thing.
So when do you advocate using this kind of stem like S-ROM stem?
S-ROM stem is good. If you are doing a S-ROM stem, is the advantage of the S-ROM stem is that you can change the version.
Yeah.
And in these cases, the version is haywire. You don't really know where you're going to get your reduction. And therefore, that S-ROM stem gives you that extra latitude of changing the version. You can do it in cement, but in the cemented thing, it's limited. But in the S-ROM, it's far more, where you can change the version a fair amount and get the stability of the hip.
So that's why, because if you are going ahead with the S-ROM, there is no other option, because the cuts and all are different for S-ROM cut is different for the cemented or uncemented hip. So you have to pre-plan it whether you are going for S-ROM or not.
Yeah, actually, you have to get the acetabulum first. Once you get the acetabulum and you've got a decent cup in properly, then you can think about it. And the S-ROM stem, etc., even though a number 6 is size, is available, the smallest ones. But even then, you have to look at the femoral thing, whether that can accommodate it or not. And then, if you are doing an osteotomy, a transverse osteotomy, and therefore an S-ROM stem, you can put it in also if it's the stem, the canal is adequate. So principally, go for the acetabulum first, look at the inferior angle, look for the ligamentum teres, etc., what remains of it, ream accordingly on a C-arm if you're not sure, and then get your cup in first. Once you've got your cup in first, you can decide whatever you have to do on this side.
So for formation of cup for acetabulum first, still you need to make space like cutting the head or making that.
The head cut always has to be there to get the space. The head cut, and even I would really also think of the trochanteric if necessary. But usually once the head cut is there, and I've done a traction film, X-ray. I know how much is going to come down. And then I think this, in this case, I think it has come down quite a lot.
In Dr. Rohit's case, it has come, but I don't think in my case, it was coming down. Mm-hmm. And although I had pre-planned that I am going to use Estrom only, and I usually cut my head before going for the Astabulum.
Yeah, absolutely. Otherwise, you won't get space.
Yeah, I won't get space. Yeah.
Sir, regarding placement of cup in false acetabulum, if we have to do it, what are the long-term implications? Because what I've heard that there's a lot of joint reaction and it loses.
Can I answer this?
Yes, please.
So regarding high hip center, it has been proposed that from the teardrop, inter-teardrop line, if your hip center is up to 35 millimeter, there's no long-term complications over it. If it is above 35 millimeter, then there are long-term complications and signs of loosening it there. Regarding this, finding true acetabulum and false acetabulum, I think Ranawat has proposed a triangle called Ranawat triangle, where you measure the distance between the iliac crest and the ischial tuberosity, divide it by 5, find the line between the intersection line between the corus line and the centrus line. From there, you draw an isosceles triangle. That is the true acetabulum where you need to put your cup inside. But from me, I think I always don't go by the true acetabulum. I will put my cup where the maximum purchase of the bone is there, up to 35 millimeter is there. I don't always want to put my cup in the inter teardrop line and put my cup to medialize it. I'll put my cup where the maximum, the good strength of the bone is there.
Okay, thank you.
One important point is also when we are dealing with the dysplastic, one of the important investigation tools should be CT scan, because most of the time you have a posterior superior bone defect also. So I think CT scan in this dysplastic mandatory. You should go for 3D reconstruction because you can plan accordingly whether you are going for any augmentation in the posterior superior aspect or not. I think we can have next presentation, case presentation. Yes.
Yes. Dr. Nirmal is here.
No,
Nirmal is. Nirmal has
some issues.
Yeah.
Unmesh and.
Next is Unmesh.
Yes, sir. So the slides are visible?
Only one case is allowed.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. So the first case, the 18-year-old female, she had a history of trauma 6 years back and complains of pain over the right hip and difficulty walking since 3 years. The movements were restricted since 1 year. She received a local treatment for the trauma 6 years back. There was a Trendelenburg gait was present, tenderness was present over the anterior joint line, fixed flexion deformity of 20 degrees and adduction deformity of 15 degrees with a limb length discrepancy of 3 centimeters. Patient wanted a painless, mobile and stable hip. So this was the pre-op X-ray. You can see the there is protrusio. We did the templating for this. This is the lateral view. The limb length discrepancy, as we could measure also on this, was 3 centimeters. The protrusio was around 2 centimeters. The native, contralateral side, the inclination was 40 degrees. With the acetabular cup templating was done, it was around coming around 48 mm. The neck shaft angle was 130 degrees. And the stem in the intramedullary canal was around 1 centimeter. Following this, this was done finally. In situ neck cut was done because we could not dislocate the head. Following which, reaming was done in the same position. Medial reaming was not done, only just peripheral reaming was done. Medial reaming, the medial aspect of the bone was paper thin, only with the subchondyle, the cartilage was removed with a ring curette. And finally, morselized bone graft was added to it. And to it, this was done. The templating was also done for the post-op. There was no limb length discrepancy. The inclination was achieved around 40 degrees. The cup was 48 mm, as we had done in the preoperatively. The head size was 32. The horizontal offset was 32 mm and vertical was 38.
Yes, comment from the experts.
Sardar sir.
Can I see the last X-ray? It looked good, yeah. Obviously, the screw is a bit no peripheral sir. Screw support. I'm not what was the screw? It went straight into the middle, I think.
Yes, sir. The screw that, went.
That space was a little less, so maybe a peripheral screws would have gone into good bone.
Posterior superiorly, the bone was deficient over there, intraoperatively. We added a bone graft on over the medial aspect, and on that we tried to take purchase with the screw.
Nishikant, your comment?
So looks great. My only concern is the flexion deformity in the right hip.
The flexion deformity was still present post-operatively.
Yeah.
We did not release the flexors.
You could have released the adductors?
Yes.
Adductor tenotomy wasn't done. Post-operatively, the range of motion was checked. The abduction was good. And in adduction also, it was stable.
So the adductors can release this flexion deformity as well.
Okay, sir.
The adductors are flexures of the hip as well. So if you release the adductor, it will increase your abduction also and decrease the flexion deformity as well.
Okay, sir.
So I have one comment on the technique. So in these protrusio hips, is peripheral reaming enough?
So there was actually no bone over the medial aspect. The medial aspect was paper thin.
I'm asking Sardar sir, if you can guide us. Is peripheral reaming enough for such hips?
Yes, the peripheral, you don't have a choice because what are you going to do? The baseline is so paper thin that no way you have to get a peripheral fit. And that's what Nishikant was saying about the PSL cups. Anyway, the peripheral would be the only one. The only thing, my worry was the screws. Rajiv, no CT scan. You know, that would have given us an idea. Here, the superior aspect looks pretty good.
Yeah, there's no reason why the one screw could not have been put in the
superior. I think while rotating the acetabulum, try to put the central hole in the 12 o'clock position. And that is the best way. You put 3D screw in the superior quadrant. Okay. I think that is the best way we follow. But if you try to put it anteriorly, the center hole is at 11 o'clock position. I think that is the reason you put it, the medial screw will always go towards the acetabulum side.
So do we over-ream while doing such cases? Should we over-ream?
Over-ream, you can't over-ream the base.
Peripheries.
The peripheries, yes. Over-ream in the sense that you have to put in whatever fixation amount of acetabular cup in good contact with bone. So that would ensure whatever the reaming has to be done there, you must get a good area of superior acetabulum surface, the superior implant surface and bone.
So I'm just asking as a technical this thing, that do we over-ream and put a bigger size cup and try and get the best fit to try and get the best fit?
Yeah, that's
over-ream put a big size cup.
Bigger size cup means a bigger size area of acetabular cup which can integrate.
Yeah. Thank you.
Wonderful presentation, Dr. Unmes.
Yes.
Next
is Dr. Subhendu. Subhendu is here.
Yeah, I think it's. You can ask Shobhik also. Shobhik is there.
So, Shobhik? Shobhik?
Yeah, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Should I share my slide?
Yes. Yeah.
This is Shivan. Hello. Excuse me.
Share your slide.
Yeah, I'm trying. So.
Shubhendu, you can try by that time, I think. There's some issue with sobbing.
Shubhendu?
I think there is something. Sobhik, what is the issue?
Yeah, sir. Actually, in the share screen, after clicking the share button, this PowerPoint.
You first open your PowerPoint, then try to share screen. Huh? First, yes, open your PowerPoint.
I open the PowerPoint.
Try to click on the share screen, the green arrow.
Yeah, green arrow. I'm sharing.
Now you will see your PowerPoint there in the screen.
Yeah, click, it's not showing. That is the issue. Sir. It's not showing that.
Not showing. PowerPoint
window is not showing.
Well, it's some technical issue there. Shubhendu?
Robic, you go to the setting.
Setting,
and then see allow Zoom to share your data. Zoom को allow करो.
हाँ.
Yeah.
Now your slides, we can't see your slides.
Yes, sir. Now is it visible?
No. Open your slide. Yeah.
Yeah, sir. Actually, slide is open. It is not visible now.
No.
You do that again. Do that again.
Make your PowerPoint full screen and then share.
Yes, sir.
Your PowerPoint, make it full screen and then share.
It is full screen now.
Presentation board. Now try to share. Yes.
Now share.
Now you are sharing your screen only.
Yes, sir. Is it visible now, sir?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, esteemed faculties and my seniors and colleagues. My case is basically one revision case. The patient was a 59-year-old sedentary worker. He had a history of GCT operation in the left hip 18 years ago. There is no document available, but as per the history, the hip dislocated immediately post-op and that was left untreated. Because he was a sedentary worker, he never returned to normal walking after surgery and adjusted to it. However, he presented with a sudden inability to walk since last 1 week. On medical history, he was hypertensive. On examination, there was tenderness was there. There was abnormal mobility on the left thigh. Along with swelling, there was no sign of infection. And approximately, there was 10 centimeters of shortening and blood parameters were within normal limit. So this is the X-ray. You see the as the patient was operated previously with a bipolar implant, the stem is broken and there is a proximal femoral bone loss.
Appears to be Austin move.
Yeah, yes, sir. Austin move. We ordered CT scan to look for any bone loss and for preoperative planning. So regarding management, we evaluated the patient and the patient was once medically conducive for operation, we planned for revision THA. So the aim was to reconstruct the hip biomechanics to restore the limb length, the center of rotation, to restore the hip offset and to prevent recurrent dislocation. So among the, all the options, we had this, we chose this modular revision tapered stem, uncemented stem. This rib stem we chose for this patient, that is a modular stem. It is a proximal modular component, propionary component, and one is meta-diaphyseal component. And this stem, the beauty of this stem is it is a provision of distal interlocking. So this would provide stability. The intra-picture, we put a prophylactic cable. And this is the immediate post-op. We follow up after 2 years. The patient is pain-free. He resumed his work. He has a satisfactory range of motion. However, there is 2 centimeter shortening and he's walking with a crutch. I would ask comments from experts regarding other management options in this case.
Yes, Nishikant.
So why have you used reef stem in this case? But the whole the proximal femur has been lost. So reef stems are not for these kind of cases. You can always use the mega prosthesis kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, sir. Mega prosthesis and this option is allograft prosthesis composite and mega prosthesis.
But the whole stress will be over the stem. You might see that your stem getting broken in near future.
Exactly, sir. But the allograft was not available, and for mega prosthesis, the affordability was an issue in this case.
The mega prosthesis comes in a cheaper price than a reef stem.
Sardar, sir.
The mega prosthesis on the link.
Yes.
From the link is much cheaper than the reef stem.
Availability was an issue, sir, in this area.
Actually, Sardar, sir, your views?
The hip is basically just surviving on the acetabular cup.
Yes, sir.
There is no muscle attachments to the anything anywhere. So the whole thing is what we were talking about earlier, the lack of abduction power, this, that, etc. So it is surviving only by the fit of the acetabulum and the screws and this. A mega prosthesis should be done. A mega prosthesis in these cases will give you a better, slightly better option.
Yes.
It'll be cheaper, But the whole thing revolves around getting some muscle power into the proximal portion. Now you won't get it because everything is gone. So there is no way of achieving any muscle power in this hip. And so you have to depend entirely on the femoral stem, which is of a short duration, and you have to depend on that upper border over there, the upper thing. I don't know how long this will survive, but so far, if it survived for 2 years, I think that's good. And if it goes any further, then it's fine.
Yes, and that is a learning point in this case.
Yeah, but
so my question is, should we go for such type of surgery? Patient is young and he has to go for long.
Yeah, the other alternative is the ischial weight-bearing caliper. That is the only thing that that is going to last a longer time. This is a good one for the oncosurgeons. I don't think anything is going to last too long. And you have to think of something like, it is basically behaving like a big girdle stone.
I think mega procedure survival ranges from 5 to 15 years. I think average survival is from 5 to 15 years. So
15 years is huge, but then not in this sort of case.
Issues with that is the chances of breakage at the bone and metal junction in this stem here.
Everything can break.
Yeah.
Yes.
Keep close follow up, Sabit.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Excellent presentation. Please just stop your sharing. Now, Subhendu is here.
No, Subhendu, I think some network issue is there. Govind, we can.
Yes, sir, my network.
Yeah, it is there.
Yeah. Start your sharing. Only one case is allowed.
Yes. So this is a 60-year male patient, sir, with 1 month old history of fracture, pain in the left hip, right hip, sir, and with case of fractured neck of femur right side, sir, and we went with total uncemented total hip replacement.
So opinion from Nishikant.
Why have you opted for the total hip arthroplasty? Why not bipolar?
Vendo.
I mean, you have done a good job.
Yes.
Why you opted total hip replacement? Why not partial?
He was 60 years old, sir. So we preferred this.
Okay, you mean to say you want to give the implant which is long lasting and the patient don't need any revisions in its future. That's why you opted for that only arthroplasty. Very, very nice. Good. But what are the precautions you are going to take in these fresh fractures next femur, 1 month old fracture next femurs? What are the risks involved? There's increased risk of limb discrepancy, which you can see it here. You've already lengthened here. The increased risk of dislocation is there. So how are you ever going to prevent it?
Sorry, sir, I cannot
hear you. There is a limb length discrepancy. So the operated limb appears to be lengthened.
Yes, sir.
Mild
lengthening was 1 centimeter lengthening.
How are you going to solve near future? What is your precautions?
Sir, careful pre-operative templating is required.
Which approach have you used?
This is a posterior lateral approach.
Posterior approach.
Yes.
Sardar, sir, your views?
Yeah, It's okay. The 60-year-old with a 1-month-old, and if she wants mobility and all, the concept of that is fine. There is quite a big gap between the acetabulum and the bone. Yes. And just one screw holding it, I think. So you must have been quite satisfied with the stability when you push the uncemented cup in. Otherwise, a couple of screws would be better.
So one question, Sadar sir, should we go for immediate weight bearing or should we delay weight bearing?
There is no point in delaying weight bearing in this case. And yes. I think this is one of the cases where I was saying that if you give immediate weight bearing, there could be the possibility of the acetabular shell further impacting into the bone.
Yes, sir.
So I have one query which has been in my mind since I started my orthopedic career. In these fractured neck of femurs, should we, why can't we just go for total hip replacement immediately in these 60-year-old people? Should we go for total hip or should we go for partial hip replacement?
A 60-year-old fracture neck femur, I think all sorts of partial hip replacements is not going to last more than 10 years or so, at the very most. So the total hip replacement, uncemented hip replacements in a fresh fracture neck femur is a good indication, especially in an active person. And we have cases in which we've done that, and that is lasting now for about 10, 15 years. So that's an option that we use. The only thing is that the patient has to agree. The cost is there. And it's a slightly bigger operation. But given the choice, if I had no other qualms, I would go for a total hip every time for an neck femur fracture in a 60 or even a 55, provided I explain everything to them. That's also reminding us that the fractured union operations are also there, especially in our part of the country.
Yes, sir. Wonderful presentation, Subhendu. Yes. Please stop your sharing.
Thank you. I think Govind, all of them have presented.
Yeah.
We can have vote of thanks from you. Yes.
Now it is time to conclude the webinar. Wonderful webinar and excellent presentation by our experts and the case presenter. And I am thankful to our great expert, Dr. Indrajit Sardar sir, and also Dr. Nishikant sir, and our host speakers, and also the Ortho TV team. Thank you very much. And main our inspirator, Dr. Rajiv.
Dr. Rajiv. Thank you, sir. Thanks. Thank you.
All right, stay safe, stay well. Yes. Sardar sir, we are half an hour late. Sorry for that. I told Sardar sir we will leave you at 2:00, but I think discussion was it was excellent.
Sorry, sir.
I couldn't leave.
Wonderful
cases and very great discussion.
But it was excellent discussion, sir.
And nice to see Jharkhand coming up so well in all type of arthroplastic cases, and you all of you doing all the advanced surgeries now. Very good.
I think the whole of India is coming up, and that's one of the year. And Jharkhand was never lagging behind in any way from before, also.
Yes. And with dynamic secretary like Dr. Govind. Yeah.
Okay.
All right, sir. Stay well, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Happy Sunday. Happy Sunday to everyone.
Yeah. Happy Sunday.